Hello, I'm Simon Whistler. You're watching the Today I Found Out YouTube channel, and in the video today we're looking at who invented the computer mouse and its surprisingly long journey to your desk. And just before we get started, I do want to say that this video is brought to you by TunnelBear. TunnelBear makes really simple apps that help you browse a more private and open internet. For a free 7-day trial, do visit tunnelbear.com/brainfood. Doug Engelbart is widely credited as the inventor of the computer mouse. Of course, as with most inventions, nothing happened in a vacuum, and before the device that gave birth to the modern mouse was thought up, there were several exceptionally similar devices around. For the full story of the invention of the computer mouse, we'll begin by backtracking slightly to a British engineer whose invention was subsequently classified as a military secret and hidden from the public. That engineer was Professor Ralph Benjamin, who, while working for the Royal Navy Scientific Service, invented a device that functioned in an almost identical fashion to a trackball mouse way back in the mid-1940s. According to a 2013 interview with Dr. Benjamin, he was tasked by the Royal Navy with helping to develop something called the Comprehensive Display System, an early computer system that could calculate the theoretical trajectory of monitored aircraft based on the inputs of a user. The cursor on the screen was controlled by a simple joystick mechanism that Benjamin felt could be improved. After some tinkering, he came up with something that he dubbed the rollerball, which functioned almost identically to a standard mechanical mouse with an outer ball that would, in turn, manipulate two rubber-coated wheels inside, one for the x-axis and one for the y. This movement was then translated into the appropriate movement of the cursor on the screen. So why don't people say that the good professor invented the mouse? Beyond that it wasn't Benjamin's device that gave birth to the modern mouse, rather than having the desk or whatever object move the ball via friction as one moves the mechanical mouse, in Benjamin's device your hand simply directly moved the ball itself, with the top of the device exposing said ball. Essentially, it was a large, upside-down, stationary mechanical mouse. Although Benjamin's device was more precise than a joystick, it was never widely implemented, and the comprehensive display system continued to be controlled by said joystick. Due to its status as a military secret, Benjamin received little to no credit for the invention of essentially a trackball mouse, and he remains an obscure figure in computing history, despite the innovative nature of the device that he pioneered. A similar device was also developed independently of Benjamin's design in 1952 by a company, Ferranti Canada, working as contractors for the Canadian Defense Research Board. The company was, amongst other things, tasked with creating an input device for computers on a budget of basically $0. Three engineers working for Ferranti, Tom Cranston, Fred Longstaff, and Kenyon Taylor, came up with the idea of using a ball housed inside a casing that remained in constant contact with four wheels positioned around it. When the ball was rolled in a given direction, the movement of the wheels would be translated to corresponding cursor movements on the screen. Essentially, this was a four-wheeled version of Benjamin's device. As a testament to the low budget the engineers had to work with, rather than constructing a trackball from scratch, they simply used a 16-centimeter, about 6-inch diameter, 5-pin bowling ball. Because the device was invented for the military, it too was designed in secret. Ironically, in one notable way, these and other similar trackball devices that were invented before the mouse were more similar to the once ubiquitous ball version of a mechanical mouse than Doug Engelbart's first mouse. You see, Engelbart's mouse didn't use a ball at all, instead having two perpendicular wheels directly contacting the table, instead of using a ball to manipulate said wheels. While still functional, Engelbart's design had the downside of making it so one wheel was always at least partially being scraped along the surface of the desk. But we're getting a little ahead of ourselves here. Engelbart developed what is the direct ancestor of the modern mouse in the 1960s as part of an ongoing project to discover the most efficient way to interact with a computer. Engelbart felt that the current devices in use at the time, mainly keyboards, joysticks, and light pens, were inefficient. With the help of engineer Bill English, who designed the actual hardware for the first mouse based on Engelbart's idea, he developed a handheld device that housed two perpendicular wheels, the movements of which could control the on-screen cursor. Essentially, this more or less works like an upside-down handheld version of the two previously mentioned stationary trackball devices, but without the ball. Engelbart thought up the idea for this device in 1961. The first prototype was created by English in 1964. In 1966, Engelbart and English approached NASA, asking them to fund a study to determine which input device was most intuitive and efficient for controlling a cursor. According to Engelbart, the devices proposed to be tested, besides the mouse, were the light pen, tracking ball, and a slider on a pivot. The space agency, they agreed, and a series of tests were carried out. Engelbart noted of the tests, "We set up our experiments, and the mouse won in every category, even though it had never been used before by the test subjects. It was faster, and with it, people made fewer mistakes. Five or six of us were involved in these tests, but no one can remember who started calling it a mouse. I'm surprised the name stuck." Engelbart later explained it was called a mouse due to the fact that initially they had the wire coming out of the bottom like a little tail. They switched it to the top to get around one's arm getting tangled in the cord all the time. At the Fall Joint Computer Conference in San Francisco on December 9, 1968, Engelbart presented this mouse to over 1,000 computer engineers in one of the most influential computing presentations of all time, later dubbed the mother of all demos. Besides the mouse, Engelbart and his colleagues also demonstrated, in one system, a number of revolutionary concepts that are now a staple of modern computing, including hypertext, video conferencing via high-speed modem, shared screens via a network where control could be passed back and forth, a form of windowed computing, word processing, real-time digital text editing with multiple people able to edit text files at the same time with revision control, and several other forms of networked collaboration. Further, at a time when the idea of a personal computer was a little outlandish, he also demoed how such a system could be used for various personal computing needs, like maintaining a grocery list with robust organizational features built into the word processor to manage such lists. You can easily watch highlights of this presentation online. Before the presentation, some who'd heard of what Engelbart was working on had dubbed him a crackpot. After the presentation, Engelbart received a standing ovation and was described by later Xerox Park employee Chuck Thacker as dealing lightning in both hands. However, demonstrating a system amazingly far ahead of its time left some skeptical that his team's online system, NLS developed with funding from DARPA, could actually do what they'd demonstrated. One such individual was famed computer scientist Andries van Dam, who furiously berated Engelbart after the presentation, stating, "It's irresponsible and unethical for you to show something you put together for a demo and pretend it actually works," to which Engelbart stated, "No, I told him, it's real. He just wouldn't believe it until he got to SRI and saw it for himself." Despite very publicly debuting the mouse to the best minds of the computing world in 1968, Engelbart's part in its invention, and even the monumental presentation itself that greatly influenced so much of the coming decades of computer development, were largely forgotten. And so it was that, like so many other inventors before him, Engelbart did not receive the credit for his invention initially, and Bill English even still receives little credit to this day. This despite the fact that several years later, English would go on to invent the mechanical mouse that featured a ball to control the XY wheels, which would become the general design of just about all mice until the rise of things like optical mice. Beyond receiving little credits, because Engelbart and English were working for the Stanford Research Institute when they developed the first mouse, the eventual patent that was granted for it in 1970 didn't belong to them. Thus, the pair got no money for the invention other than their normal paychecks. Stanford Research Institute reportedly did make money off the patent before it expired in 1984, for instance, reportedly profiting $40,000, which is $130,000 today, when they licensed it to Apple. Speaking of Apple, the mouse as we know it today rose from obscurity thanks to Steve Jobs being, well, Steve Jobs, i.e. finding an existing technology, hiring someone to copy it, but with very subtle usability tweaks, generously marketing it, and then later getting much of the public credit for it. In this case, in 1979, Jobs agreed to give Xerox a certain number of Apple shares in exchange for allowing him to come see what they were working on at their research center. When Jobs went on a tour of the research center, he encountered a prototype version of the mouse, the ball mechanical mouse, which was invented by Bill English, who was now working for Xerox. Jobs recognized the potential of the device immediately, and he, Jobs, was very excited. Then, when he began seeing the things I could do on screen, he watched for about a minute and started jumping around the room, shouting, "Why aren't you doing anything with this? This is the greatest thing! This is revolutionary!" As it turns out, Xerox was doing something with the device and had been selling the Xerox Alto along with a trackball mouse since 1973 and would later package it with the Xerox 8010 released in 1981. However, higher-ups in the company didn't seem to properly appreciate how innovative their system was. As Jobs would later note, if Xerox had known what it had and had taken advantage of its real opportunities, it could have been as big as IBM plus Microsoft plus Xerox combined, and the largest high-technology company in the world. Jobs, stunned at this lack of vision, rushed back to Apple and had his team developing the next iteration of the company's personal computer line completely revamp their plans, demanding a window-based system with the mouse as a key component. According to Dean Hovey, Jobs explained to him later that week, "The Xerox mouse is a mouse that costs $300 to build, and it breaks within 2 weeks. Here's your design spec. Our mouse needs to be manufactured for less than $15, about $50 today. It needs to not fail for a couple of years, and I want to be able to use it on Formica and my blue jeans." Hovey then explains, "From that meeting, I went to Walgreens and I wandered around and bought all the underarm deodorants that I could find because they had that ball in them. I bought a butter dish for the body of the mouse, and that was the beginnings of the Apple mouse." As for why the Apple mouse only had one button, unlike other mouse of the day, for instance, the original had three buttons, which after much research, Engelbart and his team decided was the ideal number, Hovey stated, "There were disputes around the number of buttons. Three buttons, two buttons, one button mouse. The mouse at Xerox had three buttons, but we came around to the fact that learning to mouse is a feat in and of itself, and to make it as simple as possible with just one button was pretty important." Apple's first take on the mouse came bundled with the relatively obscure Apple Lisa computer. This was named after Jobs' daughter, who he denied was his until 1987, despite the fact that a paternity test confirmed Lisa was his daughter, and she and her mother were living in poverty, while he simultaneously was naming Apple Lisa after her. The first Apple mouse featured a steel ball to drive the internal tracking wheels. The design was overhauled once again, notably using a rubber ball for the more popular Apple Macintosh computer released in 1984, which became one of the first commercially successful devices to make use of a mouse. Microsoft came out with their own mouse in 1983 for the PC, in between Apple Lisa and the much more famous Macintosh 128K. But it was the latter that subsequently spurred the widespread adoption of the mouse. After the success of the Macintosh, other companies followed suit, and the mouse became a staple of the personal computer. Despite many at various times over the decades since predicting that the mouse would go the way of the dodo any day now, most recently because of the rise of touchscreens, the mouse is still going strong with seemingly no real end in sight. And now for some bonus facts. Besides calling the mouse a mouse, Engelbart and his colleagues called the cursor a bug. Obviously, the latter name didn't stick. And now for another bonus fact. As mentioned, despite Jobs to a certain extent himself being rejected by his biological parents, he did the same thing for a time to his first child, Lisa Brennan Jobs. She was born in 1978 to Chris Ann Brennan, an ex-girlfriend of Jobs who got pregnant with Lisa when Jobs was dating someone else. Brennan told Jobs Lisa was his, but he refused to acknowledge his daughter, even while Brennan and his daughter were living on welfare and a paternity test confirmed he was the father. By the time Lisa was nine, though, Jobs had decided to be her father, and from that point on, the two were extremely close. He had three more children, Reed, Erin, and Eve, after marrying Laureen Powell in 1991. Jobs only learned he had a sister, famed author Mona Simpson, when he was an adult, himself having been given up for adoption and Mona not. Mona has the distinction of having a Simpsons character named after her, Homer Simpson's mother. Mona, for a time, was married to writer and producer Richard Apple, who named the character after her. Besides this, Homer Simpson's mother was frequently called Mother Simpson. And now for another bonus fact. In 1967, Engelbart and English came up with an invention that in tests proved to be marginally superior to the mouse. After noting that people driving cars were capable of surprisingly subtle movements with their foot, the pair theorized that a series of pedals mounted below a table could be used to control the cursors. Though the prototype device they created outperformed their early mouse prototype, it was never pursued as a possible input device for computers. Other odd devices considered included a knee brace and a device that was controlled by movements of the user's head. And now for another bonus fact. When Jobs worked for Atari, he was given the task of trying to reduce the number of chips in the arcade game Breakout as much as possible. The task was a bit over his head, but as he'd done before and would go on to do throughout his life, he demonstrated great business savvy by giving the job to his much more technically skilled friend, Steve Wozniak. He offered Wozniak 50% of his earnings from Atari for taking the job. Wozniak then did did it, reducing the number of chips by an astounding 50, meaning the total earnings for the job were $5,000. $100 per chip removed was Atari's offer. They then paid Jobs the agreed-upon $5,000, which is about $27,000 today. Jobs proceeded to give Wozniak $350, telling him that Atari had decided to only pay Jobs $700 for the job. 10 years later, when Wozniak learned of what Jobs was really paid, he wasn't upset, but said even if Jobs had told him at the time, he'd have been happy to have given Jobs the lion's share of the earnings, even though Woz did all the work. He knew Jobs needed money at that time, and he was a friend. This would set a trend in their relationship, Woz doing the work and Jobs taking the credit and the lion's share of the money. As Wozniak said, Steve didn't ever code. He wasn't an engineer, and he didn't do any original design. Another friend of Jobs, Daniel Kotka, said, "Between Woz and Jobs, Woz was the innovator, the inventor. Steve Jobs was the marketing person." But to be fair, Jobs was one hell of a marketer, and without him, Woz probably would have just had a nice career working at HP his whole life. Jobs had to even work at prying Woz away from HP, even as their company grew, simply because Woz loved working there. So I really hope you enjoyed that video. As I mentioned at the start, this one is brought to you by TunnelBear. TunnelBear is a simple VPN app that allows you to browse a more open and private internet. Now, if you value your privacy on the internet, then you really do need a VPN. And if you're looking for a VPN, as you should be, well, TunnelBear is absolutely the right one to go for. Basically, a VPN is a service which means that companies can't harvest and store your private data. And it's really the first step that you should be taking if you want to ensure your privacy online. It stops companies from knowing where you are, what type of device you're using, and all sorts of other identifying information. Now, TunnelBear replaces all of that personal data with data from a third party, so no one knows it's you. Unlike some other VPNs, TunnelBear does take your privacy very seriously, meaning that your data is really protected. And you know, if you've ever got any questions about that or any other aspect of their service, they have an amazing support team who are waiting to help you out. However, that said, you're probably not going to need it because TunnelBear is really, really very easy to use and get set up with. You just get one account, you can install it on multiple devices, phones, computers, laptops, anything. You just install it on there and you're ready to go. No serious tech skills required. So just go ahead, protect your privacy today, and you can help out Today I Found Out and help us make this show by going to tunnelbear.com/brainfood, and you also get a free 7-day trial to try it out, and I'm sure you'll love it. And thank you to TunnelBear for sponsoring this video, and thank you for watching.